Hey! In this video you will learn how to create animation in Blender 3D space from any 2D image or drawing, as well as how to set the scene volume and animate characters using bones, and a lot of other useful information. Watch to the end. As an example, I will animate my own drawing. First, you need to prepare it for further work in the Blender. Separate some elements of the image into layers, save each as a separate PNG. I do this first step in Photoshop. All this information is described in more detail in my previous guide, Layering, Turn on the Necessary Add-in, Setting the 3D Volume of our 2D Images, etc. Therefore, I advise you to watch the first guide before you start watching this video. The elements that I want to animate, I separate into layers, finish places that are not worked out on the original image with a brush or the tool stamp. I save each prepared layer separately in PNG format in one folder. Start in Blender. We're importing our split image into the scene, but this time I'm using principled instead of shadeless in the material settings, as in the scene there will be an emphasis on the light from the lamp, which will interact with the characters and illuminate them. I arrange the layers as in the original image and start dividing the layer into segments in the edit mode. Remove the excess, set the shape of the characters and the background, stretching and moving the vertices. I do not want to stretch the video too much, and for a general understanding, I will show the process of preparing the layers at an accelerated pace. But again, all the nuances of these stages can be seen in the previous guide. When the layers are prepared, look voluminous enough, then we add bones to the character or objects. Click on Add, Armature, Single Bone. Our first bone appears, it will be the parent for all subsequent bones. I place it in the pelvic area. By the way, you can quickly change the size of the bone by pressing the S key. Go to Edit Mode. In Object Data Properties, check the boxes, names and in front so that the bones can be seen behind the layers. We select the end of our first bone and on the E key we draw out a new bone, thus creating a skeleton for our character. We do this focusing on human anatomy. I add additional bones at the ends of each limb, head, legs, arms and lamp. These are the control bones. I will talk about them in more detail later. Also, to add a new bone in edit mode, press Shift plus A, so I add legs and chest to the character. Align, move the bones relative to the character. Their further movement during animation will depend on which direction the bend is made at the joints of the bones. I connect the bases of the leg bones to the pelvic bone. By holding Shift, first select the bones that we want to attach, and then lastly the bone to which we want to attach everything. Press Ctrl plus P, select the Keep Offset option. Let's name the bones, start with the pelvic bone, select it and go to Bone Properties, enter a name convenient for you. We do this with each bone. This is done in order to be less lost in the names of the bones in the future, but this is not necessary. For pairs of bones, I add letter R or letter L for right and left, and letter C for control bones. After naming the bones, select our armature and go into pose mode and select the bone located in front of the control bone. Click on the section Bone Constraint Properties, add Bone Constraint, select Inverse Kinematics. In the target section we select our skeleton, armature. In the next we look for our control bone. In the chain length section, set the number corresponding to the number of bones that will be involved in the movement of the limb. In this case the leg includes 3 bones or arm 4, along with the shoulder, lamp 2 and head 3, the control bones do not count. In order for the control bone to work correctly, you need to go into edit mode, select it and use the Alt plus P key combination to select clear parent. This is what we do for each control bone. We return to pose mode and check the work of the bones by moving the control bone. It turned out well. I selected all the control bones and cleared the parent with Alt plus P beforehand. So we add an inverse kinematics constraint to every element we want to manipulate and animate. In the same way, for the remaining limbs, select the bone in front of the control bone, select the character's skeleton in the target section, and in the next paragraph select the control bone corresponding to the limb. In edit mode, add a bone that will be the basis of the entire skeleton, including the control bones. I place it under the character. Select with the Shift key pressed all the control bones and the pelvic bone, since it is the parent for the rest of the bones, click on the added bone, press Ctrl plus P, keep offset. Now with the help of this bone in pose mode, you can move the entire skeleton. After the skeleton is ready, we can merge it with our character. For this, in object mode, while holding Shift, select the character and the arm, as it is separated, then select the skeleton, press Ctrl plus P and select with automatic weights. In pose mode, in the Bone Properties tab, uncheck Deform for all control bones. We check the work done, how our character depends on the skeleton. I have already noted for myself the problem areas, the most obvious is the hand with a rubber, stretchable knife. To fix all the shortcomings with unnatural distortions when moving limbs, we need to switch to weight paint. For this we first select the skeleton, then the character. This mode becomes available to us in the selection tab. We select the bone we need and see a color gradient, from red to blue. The colors indicate how much the object area will depend on a particular bone. Red means the maximum dependence on the movement of the bone. Blue shows the area that does not depend on the movement of the bone. Select the Draw tool, open the Active tool and Workspace Settings section. Here we can customize our brush. The slider called Weight is responsible for the color, that is, the level of dependence on the bones. The radius of the brush can be quickly changed to the F key. I check all the bones and fix problem areas. For example, the area with the knife is not completely painted over and mostly in yellow. Because of this, the texture of the hand and knife was stretched, since not the entire area depends on the hand bone. Therefore, I paint over the hand and knife in red. Green color I put on areas that will not be strongly affected by movement. The first character is ready, I'm starting work on the second one. The principle of working on the second one is no different, except for the construction of the skeleton. since the second character consists only of a head and a hand. I'm adding bones to the mouth area to animate the facial expressions a bit in the future. I remind you to connect, set the parent, press Ctrl plus P, keep offset. So I do for the fingers, attaching them to the center of the hand, and the head with the hand to the bone, the base. I only apply the inverse kinematics constraint to the character's fingers and hat. This time I didn't bother renaming the bones because I'm lazy. After completing the work on the skeletons of the characters, I slightly adjust the visual aspect of the scene, set the properties of the materials, set the light. Here you can experiment and set your own settings suitable for your scene. In render properties, we find the color management section. I advise you to select the display settings before working on the animation. Also select the appropriate gamma and contrast. Let's start working on the animation of the character. Arrange the timeline, select the skeleton and go to pose mode. While working with the bones, I will hide unnecessary elements from the scene. Select all the bones attached to the character and press the I key. Select the location and rotation. An orange rhombus will appear on the timeline. This is the keyframe for the entire skeleton. I advise you to save a copy of it and move it to the end of the animation so as not to lose the original pose. I almost forgot to mention about setting the number of frames per second. In the output properties section, here you can change the total number of frames. The rest of the settings can be set before the final render. To animate the character, click on the white circle above the timeline. This is auto keying. Select the bone and move it. The keyframes will be set automatically. Don't forget to move the blue pointer. Keyframes can be moved along the timeline, copied and deleted. This is how I create animation, making the character move in the scene, moving the bones, choosing the right pose, taking into account the physics of objects and their properties. I carry out the same actions with the second character, gradually animating by moving the bones. Remember to always save your work, press Ctrl plus S for a quick save. Looks great. Just look
at my great boostie page.
Here you can subscribe for free, but if you have an irresistible desire to give me money, then sign up for a paid subscription, I don't mind. Order a unique drawing for yourself or your project. Thank me for the work done or ask me a question in a private chat. Do not hesitate to write to me, I will be very happy. Many thanks to the people who support me and my work. Thank you from the bottom of my heart. I need to attach a light source to a lamp model. We add an object to the scene. I added a cube and reduce it for convenience. It will be the mount between the lamp bone and the light source. Select the light source, then the cube, press Ctrl plus P, click on the vertex, then select the cube, then the skeleton and the with automatic weights. In weight paint mode, check the dependence on the bones, the light together with the cube, align with the lamp in object mode. As I said at the beginning, the light from the lamp will play a big role in the scene. Let there be animated light. You can also give the light a little dynamics, flicker, which is what I'm going to do by animating the brightness of the light sources. To do this, click on the white dot next to the setting you want to animate and change these settings with auto keying enabled. Thus, it is possible to animate almost any parameters and properties of objects. Don't be afraid to experiment with animation. Now I'll show you how I add fog to scenes. Add the cube again, it will be the container for the fog. In edit mode, with the cube selected, click on the X, then only faces. After deleting the faces, we fit the cube to the size of the scene, using Ctrl plus A apply scale. Change the timeline window to shader editor. With the cube selected, click on new. Immediately delete the principled BSDF node. Press Shift plus A and in the menu that opens, in the search bar, enter the nodes we need. We find principled volume, connect as in the video. Then we are looking for color ramp. Mix RGB. Noise texture. Gradient texture. Mapping. Texture coordinate. I set a Y rotation of minus 90 in the mapping node so that the fog is at the bottom. Set the noise texture to 4D and set W to 1. Experiment in the settings, using the gradient in the color ramp and the density, you can change the density of the fog, as well as its color. I will mainly need fog, in the lower part, so I set density not high. Also in these nodes, you can adjust the location coordinates, size, and quality. For the fog, I'll add an emission color animation to fade in at the start and fade out at the end, since the light doesn't affect the emission. I also want the fog to move around a bit in the frame, so I'll add a movement animation to the cube itself that contains the fog. Open the graph editor window in any of the sections in Blender. I do it in animation, you can do it in any other. Here you can adjust the smoothness of the animation by changing the bends of the vector. I select the animation points of the cube and set the handle type to vector. I do this so that the animation is constant and uniform, and not as it was originally set, with a slight acceleration at the beginning and slowing down at the end, creating smooth transitions between keyframes. I also animate the camera a bit to make the scene look more dynamic. I check the box against camera to view and manage it, fixing the frames of the animation. I add and adjust the bloom effect in the render properties section. In the output properties section, be sure to set the save location. I choose the AVI JPEG format and the maximum quality. After all the post-processing, you can click on Render Animation, relax, and enjoy the result. If something was not entirely clear to you, or if I missed any detail, write to me, I will prompt and discuss with you any issue. Do not forget about the Boosty page and thank you for your support. Bye!